Good evening, everyone. Today is January 8th, 2024. And on behalf of the entire iBUG team, I'd like to say happy New Year and welcome to the first iBUG Buzz Call of 2024. For those of you keeping score, this is Buzz Call number 615. And my name is Brad Snyder. And along with the ladybug herself, Sandhya Rao, we are your co-facilitators for this call. The iBUG Buzz is an open forum discussion where we talk about everything in the iOS world. That means hardware like your iPhone, iPads, Apple Watch, Apple TV. We'll talk about peripherals such as headphones, keyboards, and such. We'll talk about apps. We'll pretty much talk about anything that pertains to iOS. One things we don't talk about, we don't talk about the Mac. We don't talk about anything Android, and we don't do Windows. So with those introductions out of the way, let me hand the microphone over to Sandhya, who's going to tell us what's going on the iBUG calendar for the upcoming week. Sandhya, take it away.
All right. Yes, welcome. Happy New Year, everybody. We are getting ready for a busy week already, and we have missed you terribly. Well, sort of, some of you. Okay, we are going to tell you what's going on. All things are on Zoom. No more Clubhouse options, so I don't need to say that anymore. So let's see, what do we have for the next 2 hours? We're doing the buzz, all questions related to your iPhone, like Brad said. Midpoint of the call, we'll have our movie big reveal. Come for that, then guess the question, and you might get a prize. All right, we don't know what kind of prize you're going to get, but we'll find out. So that will be at the midpoint of the call. Then, what do we have? Tomorrow, Tuesday, the mini buzz from 5 to 6 on Zoom. Very good, very good. Then Wednesday, we're off. Thursday, we have our book club, and the book is called America's First Daughter. Oh my goodness, yes, that's what it is, America's First Daughter. And it is a rather lengthy book, so I hope you have started it. I don't think you will even make it if you read it high speed right now. So it's about 21 hours. So check it out if you have time. I hope you've read it. It'll be on, even if you haven't, come and participate in the discussion. It's told from the perspective of Thomas Jefferson's daughter and going through all the constitutional, the development of our nation, and it's really a cool topic. So that will be 6:30 on Thursday. And then Friday is our movie from 8 o'clock to whenever. And then the pre-social fun time, it starts at 7:15. We have Name That Tune, we have jokes, and just a little time to hang out with one another if you want to. And then after the movie, we'll have a discussion and trivia. So that's that. And then, no, we're not done yet. We have Sunday, we have the iBUG Cafe from 4 to 6. And we're going to be talking about the music app, the built-in music app on your iPhone. Learning all kinds of cool stuff, so definitely come and check that out. Sheree and Herbie have got that covered, so please come for that. Then, real quick, our social media, our website, iBUGtoday.org, iBUGtoday.org, is our website where you can get all the information about everything I just said. I encourage everybody to register. It's free. All of our services are free. And then you will get notifications of everything that's coming up. Okay. We have a Facebook page, X page, formerly known as Twitter. What else? We have all of our training sessions are recorded and they're available for your consideration on our website, on YouTube, and on your favorite podcasting app. Then the best part, the fun part, I wanted to tell you something new that we are starting. Kind of had a little test drive early at the end of last year. We're going to start something after the meeting. We're going to turn off the recording And then it's going to be called the afterbuzz. The afterbuzz is where we are going to, we are all going to be quiet. Our facilitators are not going to say a word unless they want to. But it's a chance for y'all to hang out. You know, people think some of us actually like one another on this call. You know, they're fun. So you can hang out and just talk and whatever. No tech, no politics, no religion. All those are forbidden topics, but everything else is fair game. So we hope that you will come for that. After Buzz will be after the recording stops. And for us, it'll be 9 central and you adjust your own time. Okay, so we hope you'll come for that. It'll be fun. So just hang on till after the meeting's over. All right, Brad, that's all my announcements.
Wow. Now you're going to have to go rest after all that.
We breathe.
Okay. You're exhausted, I can tell. Okay. We are hitting the ground running with the new year. That's fantastic. All right. Well, let's get this call on the road, as they say. One thing we always do to get things going is we like to go around the room and get everyone an opportunity to say hello. Tell us where you're joining us from. If you're new to iBUG or just new to this call, we want to hear about it. We promise not to put you on the spot too much, maybe just a little bit. But no, if you're a new caller, new joining us on the call, we do like to know, you know, what kind of Apple device, what kind of iOS devices you've got. Are you new to the Apple world, or have you been using it for a while? You've just now discovered iBUG. We want to know. We want to welcome you to the group. So let me get things started. My name is Brad, and I'm in Dallas, Texas.
My name is Marcia, and I'm from Daytona Beach, ooh, Florida.
Welcome, Marcia.
Julie,
and who else?
Bridget.
Bridget, and I was that
Marie
Leo?
Marino.
Yep.
And Liz from Fort
and
Worth.
Marie, welcome, all of you.
Pete from Florida.
Keith, Terry, welcome.
From Arlington Heights.
Hello, Tyrion.
Terry from
and John from Austin.
There, John, and did I hear Judy?
Chanel in Houston.
Hello, Chanel.
Jerry in Austin.
I'm Millie from Houston.
Who was it? In Houston. Mm-hmm. Okay. Who else we have? Welcome.
Ned from Texas.
Millie. Welcome, Ned. And
thank you.
Did I hear Millie? Welcome, Millie.
Yes, Millie from Houston.
That's it. Millie in Houston. Welcome, Millie. I know this is your first time here. We're glad you're here. Who else we got?
Ed from Georgetown, Ontario.
Welcome, Ed. Is it cold up there?
Yes, very cold. Oh, very cold.
Better up there than down here. All righty. Who else we got?
Thomas in Grand Junction.
Welcome, Thomas. And who else did I hear?
Earl in Toronto.
Hello, Earl. Welcome.
Vincent in New Jersey.
Welcome, Vincent.
Dan from Southern California.
Hello, Dan.
Deb from Kansas.
Welcome.
Paul in Ohio.
I'm sorry, I got two of you at the same time.
That was Paul. Got
Paul and
Jim in Beckentown, Pennsylvania.
Welcome, both
right
of
near
you.
PA. Yeah. Yes. Or right near Philly.
Welcome.
Thank you.
This Greg
Desi in Franklin, Tennessee.
Welcome, Desi. And who else was that?
Hi, this is Greg in Texas.
Welcome.
This is Dad from Southern California. I just want to say Happy New Year to everybody.
Welcome. Welcome and Happy New Year to you.
Jody in New Hampshire, Happy New Year.
Hello, Jody in New Hampshire. Welcome.
Elizabeth from Newfoundland, Canada.
Hello, Elizabeth. Anybody else?
Brian from soon to be the Great White North.
All right. Soon to be. It's about time. It's January.
Tomorrow.
Yeah. Welcome.
Amina from Maryland.
Welcome. Anybody else?
Amanda in California.
All right, welcome. And I heard Sandhya, welcome.
Amanda's here. Very good. Oh, sorry.
All right.
Linda from Humble, Texas.
Welcome, Linda.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
You're all from Houston.
Welcome. Well, we usually like to do our best to give our new iPhone users or new people on the call opportunity to ask some questions and get us going and try to hold off on some of our regulars and veteran callers for a little while. So, do we have any new users, any new people on the call like to get us started with a question about your device or anything related to it? Or even if you are somebody who's been on the call a while and maybe you got a new device over the holiday and you've got a question about your new device.
This is Marcia.
Marcia.
Hi.
Go ahead.
I got an iPad, which, you know, I had a tablet before it came apart. But the iPad and the voice in the iPhone are connected. So if I try to do something on the iPad, the voiceover on the iPhone, you know, it's going back and forth. I tried to hide one in the other room, but she still can hear it. I don't know what to do with
so them. Is it... you're saying if you do something on one device, the other one talks?
Yeah. Uh-huh. If I go into the iPad and I turn voiceover on so I can put the code in and I can go to some of my programs, then, well, like today I tried to turn voiceover off in the iPad and it turned it off in the iPhone. And it's just been absolutely crazy. I was trying to do something on the iPad, which is hooked up to the Alexa. And when I said something about turn on voiceover, the Alexa said, what device do you want to turn on? And I said, the iPad. And she says, I'm sorry, your washer does not accept requests. And it's just been hilarious, but it's very frustrating too. Go ahead, Jody.
All right. Yeah, Jody, go ahead.
Yeah, I suggest you turn off the HEYSIRI feature in one of them. I'd keep it on your phone maybe, but turn it off on your iPad. And then they won't both be reacting when you say it. So, you know, just go into settings, go to SIRI, and then turn off that feature where it reacts to your voice when you say the word. You know, so keep it on your phone, but not on your iPad or vice versa, whichever way you want to do it. And you can
what do you do? How do you get to it in settings? I mean, what are the steps?
Oh, well, you go to settings. And then you go down the list where until it says Siri and I can't remember. There's one other thing that's under Siri, but
under Siri
you do that
and search.
Siri and search. Thank you. And so and then you activate Siri by using the buttons instead of using your voice. You can also turn the passcode off on your iPad too. So if you don't take it out of the house, you know. And the same thing. You go to settings. You go to Touch ID and passcode, and you can turn off the passcode there so that you don't have to put it in every time you open the iPad.
That would be wonderful, but now say those steps slower. You go to settings and
you go to settings,
uh-huh.
And then you go to Touch ID and passcode. And when you open Touch ID and passcode, one of the options is to turn off the passcode, and you can do that on your iPad. So everything is under settings. So you go to settings, and then you go down the list to Touch ID and passcode for that feature, And then you go down the list until you see SIRI. And then you can go into there and turn off the voice activated SIRI so that you just use the button to turn that on.
Okay.
Well, that's all very good. But I was going to say, Marcia, you didn't say anything about saying HEYSRI that started any of this. You said you were doing something on one device and the other device was responding.
Yes. Go ahead.
I came across something I had never seen before in accessibility under settings. And it said control other devices. And the only thing, and what it showed, I have a second iPhone. It's not activated. It's my wife's old one. It sits here on the table like an iPod Touch. And I use it to play music through a Bluetooth speaker. It was listed under control other devices. I'd never seen this before. And I tapped on it. And after a minute or so, the other iPhone started talking. And what appeared on the screen, I have a little bit of vision. What appeared on the screen was what looked like an iPhone screen. And at the bottom of it was some buttons that said home button, app switcher,
yeah,
and some things that would allow me to control that other iPhone from the iPhone, my primary iPhone I was holding in my hand. Sounds to me like that's what's activated on your iPhone.
Okay. Well, it certainly gives me another place to look.
Yeah. I mean, all that stuff Jody said is good stuff to know. If you got HEY Siri connect on more than one device, sometimes it gets confused. Sounded like your A-Lady was also responding to something.
Yeah, I know.
There's a button on the top. You can just turn off the microphone when you're not using it. Or that's one thing to think about. But I would go into accessibility and explore that. It's new. I don't know when it got added. I saw it over the weekend. When I was doing something else in accessibility. So take a look at that.
Okay.
Let's go. Okay. Let's move along.
Ms. Jody, can I ask where you find that under accessibility? Is it in a voiceover or is it just in the accessibility?
Accessibility.
List?
And it just said control other devices. Oh. And then at one point this weekend, the thing started. My Mac started talking. I got to look at it more. It's something I'd like to turn off. Anyway, let's move along.
This is David with a question.
Okay. I heard Dat, and I'm not sure who else it was, but let's do Dat, and then we'll go ahead, Dat.
Yes. Thank you for taking my call. I have a mystery that I need to be solved on my messages app. I don't know what I did, but there is a particular contact that sent me an audio message. Usually when you activate the audio message, we will not play automatically. It will give you a choice, like a done button, a play, a time elapse, and et cetera. But somehow, I don't know what I've done. It just play automatically after I activate the audio, you know, single finger double tap on that audio message focus, and the message just play. It will stop when I get out of that contact on the message list. Yeah, I don't know what to do. I can't share the message or copy or move forward. Forward and message, nothing. So if anybody.
This is audio messages in
the audio messages from the messages app. Yes.
Okay. Who's got experience with audio messages in the messages app? Knows
Millie?
What's going on with that. Go ahead. Who was it?
Millie,
thank go you, ahead.
Millie. Hi. So if you're like, for example, if you want to forward a message, and it's not bringing you up to the, I guess you could say, like a context menu. A lot of the times, say I sent you an audio message and it could be like, Millie, audio message, 1 minute. If you swipe down on that message, there's going to be a react, drag item, more. And when you press more on the bottom of, on the right side of the screen, there should be a forward button and a delete button.
Yeah, it's dim. It's right now, it's currently dim. So I can't do anything.
Yeah.
It's dim. Yeah.
When you pressed more?
Yes, I selected more. It's currently dim.
Have you tried powering off your phone?
Yes. Oh. Hmm. I try everything. I try closing the app. I try closing the phone, you know, reset the, you know, you shut down the phone and restart again. Nothing. This only happens in that particular, for that particular contact, though. It's kind of weird. I don't know if
it could be something on their end.
On their end, or uncoded message, or something like that. You know.
Oh, no.
Yeah. So I'm not quite queer. No.
All right. Yeah. Well.
Oh.
Just hopefully keep messing with it, and you'll get it figured out. Don't know what else we can say.
Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. I heard somebody else in there, right, David, when
this is David.
Yeah, I just wonder if you can change the voice in detection mode. When detection mode starts talking, it's in another dialect. It seems to be English, but it's speaking real fast also.
Okay. Who knows about why he's getting a strange voice? This is when you're reading a text or an email or something?
No, this is under the magnifier detection mode.
Okay.
And it's detecting things, but whatever you choose, but it's speaking really fast and a different dialect. It seems to be English, but it says it so fast I can't tell what it's saying.
Who knows what's going on with the magnifier? Will?
This is Ed.
Ed, help us out here.
I don't use a magnifier, but it sounds like possibly if he goes into his rotor, he might be able to turn the speed of the voice down. Is there not a separate voice setting for that?
It's not that. The regular voiceover is working fine. It's just when detection mode says something is in that strange voice.
But in that mode, it has settings for the voice and possibly a speed adjustment.
Possibly.
Anyways, did I hear?
Liz,
go ahead. Maybe you can solve this puzzle.
I don't know that I can solve it, but I can tell you it's happening in other apps randomly. And the best I can find out is there's like a character that's not a regular alphabet that causes it to go into that other language that is not known by Translate. So that's happened in one of my cooking apps. And it drives me nuts because I don't understand it. And it's like, this is important. So it's doing that randomly in other apps also.
So maybe this is a bug. Oh, so maybe it'll be a bug that'll be fixed eventually.
I'm hoping.
Okay. Thank you.
This is Chris.
Okay. Go ahead.
Me? Chris? Okay. I had something happen to me last week similar. I was in an email and it started speaking French. It was not in French. The email was not in French. And then at the bottom of it, it started speaking Spanish. It was not in Spanish.
Hmm.
So I went and I looked, and in my rotor, I only have US English in my rotor for languages. But then if I flicked down and took the US English only again as a default, then it would actually speak it in English, but it was a slower speech rate. So then I went look under settings, accessibility, voiceover, speech, I think. And in there, there's that setting that says, I think it's
rotor languages.
Detect languages or.
Yes.
I forgot what it was called. So I turned that off and then I went back into my email and then it read the English as English. It did not come up with the French and the Spanish interpretations of it for whatever reason. So I had two options. I could either turn that detect other languages off under, I think it was speech under voiceover, or I could go to my rotor. And even though there was only US English, if I flicked down and took it as the default, then it seemed to fix that also. And you could see there was a separate speech rate under the speech setting too. And that's the speech rate it was talking. It was much slower. You're correct.
That sounds like it. I'd give that a try and see if that solves it.
Keep going.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Hopefully that'll fix it for you. Thank you, Chris. Okay. Who's got a next question
for us? Hi,
this
is John.
John, go ahead. John.
I've got a question that I think is simple, but I just can't find the answer. I'm being buried in spam, and I know how to move a single message to junk, but is there a way to move multiple messages to junk all at the same time and get rid of them?
Are you talking? This is Millie. Are you talking about text messages ahead, or email?
Email, Millie.
Okay, I wasn't sure if you were talking, because I know how to do it with text messages, but not with email.
This is Pete.
Okay, go ahead, Pete.
John, if you go to the top of your email account page, which is at the very top when, like, it's your inbox, if you flick twice to the right, you'll find an edit button.
Oh.
Double tap on the edit, that will activate your edit, and then you can go just flick down through your inbox and each email that you want to delete, such as all of those spams that you're talking about, all you need to do is do a one finger double tap on each of those and just keep on going down the line. And when you've edited and selected them all, you go to the very bottom of the screen and the flick to the left once, and there will be a trash or a delete item button. And then do a one finger double tap on that, and all of those will be deleted in one action.
And they will go to junk?
Yes.
No,
I'm sorry. They'll go to trash.
Okay. How do I get them to junk, though?
Go to move.
Yes.
Go to
There's
move.
There's another button, a couple of flicks to the left of the trash button will be a move, and then you'll need to identify the mailbox to which you want to move them. Then you would flick to the junk mailbox and do your single finger double tap there.
Great. That's
right, thank you, Brad. Good.
The edit is key. Pete. Thank you.
That's right.
All right. And let me remind everyone, please state your name and wait to be called upon. And don't just say your name and start talking. We try to maintain a little order that way. Go ahead, Marie.
Okay. Can I go back just real quickly to Dot's problem with his text message? If it's possible for him to get to the thread of that message before he gets into the actual text message, if you go to that thread and delete that thread, possibly that will get rid of that audio message. And then the next time he texts you, it'll start a new thread.
All right.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Marie. All right. We've got a new question, different topic, something we haven't talked about before.
Liz?
Go ahead, Liz.
Okay, I'm now a newbie as to voiceover, and I'm getting real confused real easy. Swiping and flicking, are those like real, real short gestures? Because I have trouble getting the swipe to make those sounds to close an app.
Okay. Nope. You can help Liz with her gestures. She's new to voiceover. Let's see if we can help her. Go ahead.
Hi. So what kind of iPhone do you have?
It is. I'm on notes here. 13 Pro Max.
Okay. So when you're swiping either left or right to, you know, read things on your screen, they're very short gestures, just as long as the screen, the text that your fingers are there. And then you can, you know, double tap sort of quickly. If you double tap too slowly, it won't recognize it. But if you double tap sort of quickly, it'll work. And then to get to like your app switcher to close apps, if you put your thumb on the very, very bottom of the screen and you slide it up, it'll make these sort of sounds. And when you hear three sounds, you'll get to your app switcher. And if you just swipe up with three fingers, you should be able to close your apps. But I would overall, I would say that voiceover is definitely something that will take time. And if you keep working at it a little day by day, maybe 10, 15 minutes a day, you should get better over time.
Very good.
I spend way more time on that each day. But the sounds, I can get like the first sound and then they'll do that sound that means it didn't catch it. And so I'm not on this app switcher yet, so that's like a couple lessons away.
Right.
So when I want to close something, I just, so far it works best if I swipe up a little bit and then curve over like I do when I'm not in VoiceOver. Is that correct?
So with VoiceOver, it's like a popping sound kind of, and it makes it three times. And when you slide your thumb from the bottom of the screen up, you'll hear these sounds and you should get to the app switcher. You just have to go up a little farther.
Oh. I have more luck when I kind of curve to the right as I'm going up. Huh. All right. I'll keep practicing.
Keep practicing. Try to swipe in straight lines. I know. Easier right. said than done. Just keep practicing.
I've never done anything in a straight line.
Well.
This is Sandhya.
All right, go ahead, Sandhya.
I would just, real quick, I would hold, you know, like Millie said, the thumb is your best bet because it seems to be able to, it sounds like maybe you're not, like, it's not maintaining contact with the screen or maybe. So just really kind of, the thumb gives you a little more surface area. So I would try doing what she said, you know, your thumb is vertical, I mean, you know, parallel to the bottom of the phone and then swipe up. And so hopefully that'll work. Thank you.
All right.
Okay.
All right, let's see if we can get another question. New topic. Somebody who hasn't asked a question before. Ever. No, I'm kidding.
This is Jody.
Go ahead, Jody.
Yeah, so I'm thinking about getting a Fitbit that keeps track of your blood pressure and blood oxygen and all those other things that Fitbit now does. And I wonder if, is the Fitbit app accessible and how accurate are those Fitbits that keep track of your blood pressure and blood oxygen and everything?
Did anybody use a Fitbit or the Fitbit app? Crickets. You may have to get an Apple Watch, Jody.
No, I don't want to spend that much.
I don't know.
Yeah.
This is Chris.
Go ahead, Chris.
Jody, a long time ago, my kids had Fitbits, and at the time, that app was accessible, but I'm not sure if it is currently.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Chris. Saved us. All righty.
This is Dan with a comment.
Dan with a comment. Go ahead, quickly.
I would think that if you go to Apple Viz, you know, applevis.com, they have a little section where they list all the apps that are accessible. And I would think that would be in there. That's a pretty common app, Fitbit.
All right.
Good idea. Thank you.
Good idea. Also, I think that Fitbit app is free. You can download it and see if you can take it around the block and see what it's like.
This is Vincent. All right.
Go ahead, Vincent.
A comment. I know at the beginning of the of this session, we had the magic countdown 3, 2, 1, but at least in my iPad, nothing happened. I didn't get the screen indicating that the meeting was being recorded, nor the it's OK different. or skip or enter or anything, nothing concerning the meeting information. So I just wanted to pass that on.
Did you?
This is Janet.
Okay, Janet, go ahead.
You don't get the screen anymore. You have to look to the left of your unmute button. There's an okay.
Start swiping. You should find it. Were you unmuted at the beginning? And unless you get it, it's not called got it anymore. It says
okay. Yeah, it's called okay.
Hang on, Janet. And if you haven't got it, if you have not found the okay button and activated it, if you mute yourself, you may not be able to unmute. If you're unmuted when the notification goes out, it doesn't mute you. You stay unmuted. At least that's how it used to be. But if you should mute yourself without acknowledging that the meeting is being recorded and selecting what is now the OK button, there's no more got it button. If you've done the update, there's some people who haven't done the update, so they still get a got it button. But at least that's how I believe it works. So like Janice said, it's on the bottom. I don't use an iPad, so I haven't used one in a long time, so I'm not sure where it is. Okay?
Well, at least that's where it is on the iPhone. It should be in that somewhat area on your iPad, and there is a new Zoom update that came out today. Right. I didn't get it
but
yet.
That's separate.
Yep.
This is Ed. Thank you, Janet. Go ahead.
This is I looked for an OK button, didn't find one, and my mute is working fine. I'm on and off, and no problem.
All right. Well, I guess that's a mystery of the universe, then. I don't know. Gary. Go ahead, Gary.
Yeah, I inadvertently found it right to the left of the mute and unmute and mute and unmute button, and between right there and leave. And when you double tap the OK, then if you flick to the left now, I just said this meeting is being recorded. So it's between the unmute, mute, and the leave button.
And that's on an iPad, correct?
On an iPhone.
Okay, iPhone there at opposite corners of the screen.
Yeah, it's on the lower left.
Yeah, unmute is in the lower left and leave is in the upper right.
Okay, well, if I flick to the left from mute.
Right.
I see, that okay, and then leave. But I know leave, okay. If I go to it, it's...
Yeah. It's in the screen someplace. Just swipe around and you find
it's
it.
It's between to the left of mute and unmute, more or less.
Yes.
This is Ed. Sorry, I found it. It's to the left. I never looked to the left, just to the right.
Okay,
got it. Thanks.
Good.
Okay.
Very good. All righty. Who's got a new question, new topic? Somebody
Bridget.
Hadn't had an opportunity. Go ahead, Bridget.
Okay, on my phone, I get a lot of messages. I guess it's emails or messages. Then it says attachment. But how do you read the attachment?
In an email?
Not a, they just, is it email? I think it's.
Yeah, it'd probably be an email if it's got an attachment. Who could tell Bridget about how to get to attachments in an email message?
Millie?
Millie, go ahead.
So it depends on the kind of attachment. If it's a picture, it might not really work. But if, like, let's say if it was a Word document, you should be able to click on when it says attachment, you should be able to double tap with a finger and it'll take you in to it and you should be able to read it. But like I said, it really depends on the kind of attachment it is.
This Marie.
Go ahead, Marie.
I thought she said she was getting an alert that she had a text message that she should go into the messaging app rather than into mail.
Don't get attachments and text messages though.
I didn't think she said anything about an attachment.
She
I
said
thought
notifications
she said,
or whatever, but yeah.
This is Pete.
Go ahead, Pete.
I thought she said attachments too. So Bridget, if you open your email app, your mail app at the bottom, then you need to find the email that has the attachment on it. And once you do that, you open that email, then the attachment will appear at the very bottom of that email screen.
So you can either flick to the right until you get all the way to the bottom and you'll hear the word attachment from VoiceOver. And then you do a one finger double tap on that and it should open up a new screen, which will be the attachment. Now, you don't know what it is, like Millie said. It might be a photo. It might be some sort of a document, like a Word document or a PDF document or something like that. But if you look at the very bottom of the email, the screen that shows the email, you'll hear the word attachment and just do a one finger double tap on that.
Okay, thanks. But let me state, I think I said, the wrong thing. It's not an email. It's that I get community messages and people are looking for their dog, and they might have pictures and they say about the dog, and they say attachment to tell you more about the dog.
Yeah, that sounds like another kind of app. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's not an email.
Right.
I think it's a text.
My wife uses an app called Nextdoor, and same kind of thing.
Yeah, that's the name of it, Nextdoor, and I get a lot of messages from that with attachment.
Yeah, they're just in the message. How would I open it? Just double tap on your screen, and it should open them. Okay?
Okay. All right. That's fine. Thank you so much.
The notification on your screen, and it should open whatever app that notification is about.
Okay.
You probably have to have your iPhone unlocked. Okay. Give that a try. Hopefully that'll work for you. Okay. Who's got another next question for us? We still got plenty of time till the halfway point. Anybody hadn't had a chance to ask a question?
It's Earl.
Oh, hang on. Who did I? Did I hear Paul first and then Earl?
Yeah.
Paul and then Earl. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. If you're using an iPad and your iPhone and iPad are on the same account, and let's say you're working on the iPad on a document or something and you don't want to be interrupted by your text messages popping up, can that be turned off in the settings? Don't let it pop up, don't display it.
Yeah, who can help him out with these? What do you got? Notifications popping up on more than one device, right?
I want to set it so it doesn't come up on the iPad. So somebody sends me a text message, it'll show up on my phone, but it wouldn't show up on the iPad.
Okay.
I know you can't uninstall the app. Which, you know,
no.
That, but there should be a way to turn that
off. Who can help him out with a? Two devices, and he's getting text message notifications and other notifications as well, or just text message?
Primarily the text message.
Text messages.
Millie?
Go ahead, Millie.
A suggestion I have would be when you're on your iPad doing something important, turn on Do Not Disturb, and it shouldn't go through, and it should just go through to your phone.
This is Chanel.
Go ahead, Chanel.
I would also recommend, in addition to Do Not Disturb, there's something called Share Across Devices. And if that is on, that'll turn on Do Not Disturb on the iPhone as well. So you might, on the iPad, when you go turn on Do Not Disturb, go into your Settings app and go into Focus. And then there's something at the bottom that says Share Across Devices, and you want to have that off if you only want the Do Not Disturb to apply to the device where you turned it on.
What about managing notifications, Chanel?
Huh?
Managing notifications, I'm thinking. Go into the notifications on the iPad and turn off notifications for your messages.
Do that too.
This is Pete. That way
you don't have to
fool
with Do Not Disturb.
Right. Just turn off notifications from your messages app, Paul.
Go ahead. Who hadn't had a chance to ask a question?
Earl?
Go ahead, Earl.
Got a quick question about Zoom. I used to be able to see who was speaking. I'm running the latest version of Zoom, latest version of iOS, but I no longer see who's speaking with VoiceOver. Does anybody know what I might have to check? I have self view turned off.
when I go into the meeting, but I'm not seeing, I used to see at the top left who was speaking.
The top left or in the center of the screen?
Used to be at the top left for me, but I don't know if that's okay. Changed.
Who's familiar with?
This is Ed.
Okay, go ahead, Ed. I didn't.
I believe if you swipe to the right, and you might have to hit more. There's a place where you can turn on the speaker. And it'll show at the top of the screen.
No, I don't want like the speaker, like not the speaker for Zoom, but I want to see who is speaking.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Very good. Thank you, Ed. Okay. Did I hear somebody else in there? Did anybody else got a question for us?
This is Ned.
Go ahead, Ned.
Yes, I was in Safari a couple of days ago, and I came across this message. Safari has blocked 37 trackers from profiling you. And then I noticed that number goes up and down. So who might be the trackers that are profiling me or trying to profile me?
I can tell Ned about tracking on a web browser.
Liz?
Go ahead, Liz.
Any of the places that you've done searches for, any place that you've shopped at or looked at objects to purchase, are your main people that follow and track you so that they can do ads specifically for what you are interested in, like cookies.
Very good. Pretty much any website can or may or may not be tracking, have a tracking thing going on. And as far as telling you, it's blocking that stuff.
This is Ned.
Go ahead, Ned.
So that is something that is programmed into the security when we're getting we get these updates from Apple. Is that where this is coming from? Is the blocking is coming from the
security? No, it's something in Safari. It's got security in it that blocks tracking from websites, and it's letting you know that it's been working hard for your security. That's pretty much it. All right.
This is Dot.
Go ahead, Dot.
With a new question.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any way I can use my iPhone or to record directly from a mixer, for instance? So I know I can record from a voice memo, but I don't want a background sound, sound in the back. So I want to record a karaoke party, for instance, but directly from the mixer. How do I go about, what kind of apps do I have to install?
Who knows about using an iPhone with a mixer? Anybody done that?
Directly from a sound system.
I got somebody unmuted with some stuff in the background. I hear it. Or maybe that's that. Anyway. Anybody got any experience using a mixer and connecting their iPhone to it?
This is Pete.
Go ahead, Pete.
I have come up empty. Is that Dot who asked that question?
Yes.
Dot, I don't know, but you might want to go and just Google something like iPhone or mixer or recording. You know, try to come up with a search term and Google
to record direct from using iPhone, right?
Yeah, and see what devices are out there. There used to be some kits and things like that that were available, and they just plug into the Lightning port on your phone.
I always want to do that.
Yeah, I think you probably still can, but I don't know what they are, so I would Google it.
This is Dan.
Go ahead, Dan.
I believe Boss Jock will do that. I'm not sure, but it seems to me I read something about that. So you might want to check on that app in the App Store to see if Boss Jock will do that for you.
This is Pete.
Go ahead, Pete, and then let's move on.
Dan, I don't believe Boss Jock does that. He wants to connect something directly from his mixer into his iPhone that will then just pick up what comes through the mixer. Boss Jock is a standalone app, at least it used to be, unless it's changed recently. It's a standalone app, kind of like voice memos, where you can do recording. It gives you a lot of editing features in the Boss Jock, which is now called Backpack, by the way. If you want to check that app out, Dot, it's Backpack, yes. Two words. Yeah. But I don't think it's capable of handling a direct line into the Lightning port from the mixer, but Google it.
Thank you, guys.
All right.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Good luck, Dot.
Thank you.
Okay, we still got a few minutes. Who's got a question? Somebody hadn't had a chance to ask a question or even respond to a question. Who's got a question that they've been wanting to ask? Was that Linda?
Yes.
Yes, Linda. I understand you got a new iPhone.
No.
No, wrong one. Never mind.
No, I did. I had it for a week or two, and I returned it.
Oh, okay. Go ahead. Sandhya.
In the email, is there a way to delete folders that you're not using anymore or that are outdated?
Management. Okay. Who can help Linda out with deleting folders in her email?
This is Jerry from Vermont.
Go ahead, Jerry.
If you go to your folders in email are usually called mailboxes. So if you go to, I got my mouth full of pizza. If you go to mailboxes and hit edit, you will get a way to delete it, your folders. So go to the where all the mailboxes are. You know what I mean? Then
yeah.
You should be able to hit the edit button on the top of the screen. I did that by mistake the other day. And then you just have to flick up, I believe, or select the ones you want to delete, and you'll be able to delete them.
Okay, great. Thank you.
All right. Very good.
This is great.
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you, Linda. Okay. Who's that?
Yeah, this is Greg.
Greg, welcome.
Yeah, I think
Greg,
if you're on your list of emails, the screen that has the list of your emails, and you scrub back a screen, then that's going to have you on your list of mailboxes. And if you go find the folder that you want to delete, if you just click right until you find that folder, then you can just flick down, and I think one of the options will be delete, and it'll double tap on it. It'll delete the folder.
You sure about that?
I think I'll have to try it.
Yeah, because I thought you have to hit the edit button to edit them, to delete them, add them, delete them, things like that.
Yeah. Let me try real quick.
All right. Well, that's something worth trying. Thank you, Greg. Okay. Next question. Who hasn't had an opportunity? Trying to get some, give everybody a chance.
Eileen,
go ahead.
I was wondering if I download a book from Bard to my iPad, and then the storm comes tomorrow and I don't have electricity or Wi-Fi, will I still be able to listen to the book?
This is Jim.
Go ahead, Jim.
What you want to do, if you're worried about that, is just start playing the book once. You know, hit play, and then if you want to read it later, just hit stop, and it'll be there, and it will authorize.
Without Wi-Fi?
Well, what I would do when you download the book, okay?
Okay.
Just go into Bard, you know, where it says Audible book settings, and hit play on that book. So you know that it's authorized. Okay. Then you can stop it and come back to it later on when the winds are blowing and all the cables are down and we're good to go.
Okay.
Once you download the book from Bard, it's on your device. And you do not have to have Wi-Fi or any connectivity. You just have to have power on the iPad or iPhone or whatever that device is.
Okay.
It's already authorized because you're signed into your Bard account.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Okay. New question, new person. We got 3 minutes. We can get a couple of quickies in here.
This is Jody.
Hang on, I heard Jody. Who else did I hear?
This is Deb.
Let's go with Deb.
Jody, I just had a comment for the lady who's having a little bit of trouble with her app switcher. Maybe she could put it on the back tap feature, either for a double tap, back mm-hmm. tap, or a triple tap. You could use the app switcher. Could be one of those. Might be a good way for her to do that.
Very good. It's good advice. I think she was just trying to figure out some of her basic gestures. She said she hadn't even gotten as far along to get to app switcher yet, but that's very good advice. Very good. Thank you. Anybody else who hasn't had
a... Jody with a comment.
Yeah, Jody, go ahead real quick.
Yeah, I just want to say, as far as Bard goes, if the book is on your bookshelf, then it's on your device.
Exactly.
If the book is in the wish list, then it's still on the server at the library. So when you tap on a book in the wish list and you add it to your bookshelf, then you're moving it from their server to your device.
Very good. All righty. Got 2 minutes. Who's got a quick question for us?
Maybe this is
got
Ed.
Time for one more. Who? Go ahead.
Ed, just a comment, please, to the lady that's having a problem with gestures. There's a setting where you can slow down the gesture from like 0.25 seconds to 0.35 or 0.4. And I think that would probably help her also.
Very good.
Okay.
And can you remember where that is?
Oh.
It is in VoiceOver. I believe it's all the way almost to the bottom. I'll look again in a minute. It's been a while since I've done it.
This
I know
is
where
Pete.
They are, but go ahead, Pete. Where is
yes, it is there, but it only applies to the double tap.
It's the double tap only. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Double it's tap
the,
timeout.
Double tap timeout is the name of the setting.
It won't help you with
I think that's probably too far down the line for her.
Yeah, I think so.
At this point
I think
in time.
So.
Yeah.
All righty. Thank you. And you know what? We are at 59. I'm going to call it close enough to the top of the hour. Sandhya, are you ready for the baton?
Yes, I got it. Thank you, Brad. All right. Welcome, everybody. Okay, this is the midpoint. Great first half there and great participation. I love it. So we would like to give anybody who didn't get to say hello initially, just say your name, where you're from. If you hear for the first time, tell us that as well, please. Who'd like to go?
Janet in snowy Colorado.
Welcome, Janet.
Arlene,
this is
North
David
Carolina.
From Houston.
Arlene, Miss Arlene and David, welcome.
Sheree from Virginia.
Hey, Sheree, welcome.
This is Dee.
Hello, Dee, welcome.
Thank you.
Sounds so nice sometimes. Okay. All right. Keep going. Who else? We love D. Okay. Who else? Nobody else wants to say hello?
Is Chris with her fire baton again?
Hey, Chris. Welcome. Anybody
hi,
else?
Vanessa from Georgia.
Hey, Miss Vanessa. Welcome.
Hey. Hi, guys. Thank you.
Hershey from Central Florida.
Hey, Hershey, welcome.
Yes, Dawn from Houston.
Hey, Dawn, welcome.
Thank you.
All right. All these lovely people on our call. Okay, who else? Any more not lovely people? Okay. All right, I'll stop while I'm ahead. Okay. Getting some background noise. Okay, So, I guess we know what's going to happen now. We're going to find out what the big reveal is, the movie for Friday. And with those amazing clues, we're going to ask, check on who's out there to give them to us. Hopefully it's the iBUG guy. iBUG guy, are you out there?
Yes, yes, yes. I'm back. Happy New Year. Oh, I forgot to have my horn ready. Darn it. Anyway, Happy New Year. Good to see everybody back for 2024. And we've got many clues for you in this coming year. Better and bigger and wilder than ever. So we will start off, and these clues will enable you to guess the movie for this Friday, maybe, if you're good. But before we get into the clues, remember last year we ended by going through a lot of things you can do with that wonderful old hairspray. Well, we're moving on to vinegar. Yes, distilled vinegar. Things you can do with vinegar. And for tonight, did you know you can care for your windshield wipers? Or if you don't drive, then maybe someone you know, you can care for their windshield wipers. Instead of using that corrosive chemicals, just get a rag soaked in distilled vinegar, apply it gently to those windshield wipers. It will take all that crud off and restore the rubber to its original state, and they will last much longer. So that's our vinegar helper of the week. Now we are ready for Meg.
Uh-oh.
Oh, boy.
Little boy.
He'll be back.
The question is when.
All right, here we go. We've got five fabulous clues if we get that far. And there are rules. You may stay unmuted as long as you don't have a lot of background noise and just say your name, wait to be recognized when you want to guess the title of the movie. And you get one guess per clue. So let's get ready for clue number one. Our film this week is set in the Midwest. After the turn of the last century. It's set in the Midwest, not saying which Midwest, after the turn of the last century. Oh, Dot, go ahead.
The color purple.
That was, I think, before the turn of the last century, but good guess, Dot.
Thank you.
All right. Anybody else want to take a stab at it? Ooh, I let that one slip out. Clue. All right. Moving right along. Who was that?
That was Brooks.
Oh, Brooks. Go for it.
How about The Sting?
The Sting. That's the right time period. And I don't even remember where that was happened. May have been in the Midwest, but we don't know. Oh, that is kind of in the Midwest.
We've seen it.
So guess what, Brooks? We can't see it again.
Maybe Nikki.
In another lifetime. Oh, Nikki.
Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
Yes, Nikki knows her movies with Robert Redford. Unfortunately, it's not the one we're seeing tonight, this week.
I just came in, so I don't even know, but I thought it's a good guess. So
it was a great guess. Not,
but it's wrong.
We're moving right along. Going
this
to
Vincent.
Oh, Vincent.
The this Flowers is of the Killer Moon.
Flowers of the Killer Moon.
Man, the new movie. Well, new.
New. Yeah, it just came out.
Just came out, yeah.
Well, I don't even know about that one, but.
And it's about 14 hours, I think, to listen to, isn't it? Something like that.
Right.
No.
3-hour movie.
Well, it's too new.
I read the book.
Who read the book?
D.
Do you read the book? What do you think of it?
I read the book, Killer of the Flower Moon, yes.
Was the book good?
Yeah.
Well, guess what?
It was.
The movie's going to be even better. Ding, 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 ding. Dot, got it, dot, got it.
Dot. That's a brand new movie. Wow.
Wow,
that's
brand new.
It is. It was released in October and very likely be nominated for Best Picture. And
it
some other awards
yet for streaming.
I think the global, whatever those global awards were.
Golden Globes.
Golden Globe.
Golden Globe.
Going to Apple TV this Friday, I think.
Yeah, it started on Apple TV.
Friday, the 12th.
It's starring more of those people from the movie from last week. Well, those kind of people. We're not stereotyping anyone, but lots of people with names that end in I are in this movie. Leonardo DiCaprio.
Capriole,
right?
And De Niro. And Martin Scorsese.
He directed it.
And as Nikki said, it is a mere 3 hours and 26 minutes. So be sure to get your nap on before you come in for this one.
And it started an hour early?
Because we are going overtime and covering two different days. It will start on January 12th and end on January 13th. Be there.
Michael, this is Nikki.
Yeah.
The book is 14 hours.
Okay, the book's 14 hours.
Yeah.
Okay. The movie's only 3.5.
Yeah.
It's much more condensed. Okay, so congratulations, Dot. All
right. This is Sandhya. Wait, it's Vincent who got it, not Dot.
What?
I thought it was Vincent.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah,
it was somebody
Vincent.
Else.
Yeah, it was Vincent.
Vincent?
Yeah, Vincent got it.
Well, I didn't know I got it.
How did he?
I heard him.
Vincent snuck in there. Okay, Vincent.
Yeah.
Sorry about
Vincent.
That. Vincent.
Okay. It's Children of the Flower Moon.
No.
No, stop. It's not.
Okay, let's go on. Let's not confuse. Go ahead.
Children of the Corn.
Okay, go on.
All right.
Johnny, what do we have for Vincent?
All right, here comes Vincent. Very good, very good, Vincent. Congratulations, Vincent. First time guest on the very first guest. That's so awesome.
Yeah.
And you will have, you're going to have? Quiet in the peanut gallery. All right, Vincent, you're ready? You're going to have one barrel of oil for the rest of your life, for each day. Each day for the rest of your life, barrel of crude oil, current value is $76.12. It could go up or down, so you're going to be good. All right, there you go. We couldn't give you an oil well, but we're going to give you some oil.
Texas oil.
Texas oil, Texas tea, black gold.
Oklahoma oil.
He's sitting in Oklahoma, though.
It is in Oklahoma. We got it. We know that. Okay, so very good, very good. And good job, Mr. McCulloch. You're going to say good night. Okay.
A topic that has come up several times on the Buzz Calls recently
has been the Siri follow-up feature that was introduced with iOS 17. And one of the questions about this feature is, how do I dismiss it when I'm done? Or what do I do about the fact that it cuts me off when I'm trying to speak to it? So I'm going to see if I can address some of those issues in this BuzzBite segment. During our last call, we actually had a caller who responded that in their experience, the way to dismiss the Siri follow-up feature was to do a hard reset of their iPhone. And that simply is not necessary. So we're going to take a look at how to dismiss the Siri follow-up feature, as well as look at some other settings that may help us out in using it. So I'm going to unlock my iPhone.
1503. Back.
Okay, and I'm now on the home screen. So as we know, to initiate Siri, you can do it a couple of ways. You can have your phone set to listen for the command, where you can either say HEY Siri, or beginning with iOS 17, you can just simply say Siri, and that will initiate Siri, and she will listen for your initial command. Other way is to hold down the side button on your iPhone and continue holding it down while you give your initial request, and you continue holding it down until you're done speaking and then let go. Or if you're using an iPhone that has a home button, you press and hold the home button while you give your initial request and let go of the button once you are finished. So I'm going to ask Siri some questions about the weather. And when I'm done, I'm going to show you how to dismiss it. There are two ways to dismiss it, by the way. First one is to simply press the home button if you have an iPhone with a home button, or the side button if your iPhone does not have the home button. The other way is to just simply ask Siri, or say to Siri, thank you, and Siri will respond, you're welcome, or something similar, and the follow-up feature is dismissed. So let's see how it goes here. Hey Siri, what's the weather today?
It will be windy today. Daytime temperatures will hover around 58 degrees, with overnight lows around 39.
Will it rain?
It doesn't look like it's going to rain today.
What's the forecast high temperature?
The high temperature will be 58 degrees Fahrenheit today.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
And Siri is dismissed, and it has gone back to my home screen. So let's take a look at a couple of other settings for Siri and the follow-up feature. I'm going to open up Settings.
Settings.
And I'm going to navigate to the Accessibility item. This is way down here at the bottom. So let's see if I can get there quickly. I'm going to use four-finger tap on the bottom of the screen.
For app settings, button.
And it is the third from the bottom.
Access Siri button.
Here it says Siri, third from the bottom. Let's open it up and see what we've got.
Selected, automatic.
Okay, now I'm up at the top.
Siri, heading, type to Siri, switch button, off.
I have type to Siri turned off. You may want that on, either way.
Siri will listen for voice input when you press and hold the side button.
Okay.
Siri pause time, heading.
This is what we're looking for, Siri pause time. This will tell us how long Siri's going to wait for you to finish speaking.
Selected, default.
Mine's set on the default. There are two other settings.
Longer.
Can have it be longer.
Longest.
Or longer, even longer, called longest.
Set how long Siri waits for you to finish speaking.
Okay, that's what I just said. So let's move on.
Speaking rate, heading.
Okay.
Speaking rate, 100%, adjustable.
I think that's how fast Siri speaks to you. I've played with this and it didn't seem to change. Maybe that's how long I speak. I'm not sure. I've left it at 100%.
Spoken responses, heading.
Okay.
Prefer silent responses.
If you want Siri to just print out responses on the screen, that's kind of for a sighted user.
Selected, automatic.
Automatic is what I have selected. That's the default.
Prefer spoken responses.
Okay, or you can prefer spoken responses, which I believe means Siri will always speak responses.
Siri will use on-device intelligence to automatically determine when to speak.
Okay, maybe that's because I've got automatic. Maybe that's because I've already got automatic selected.
Always listen for Hey Siri. Switch button off.
This is the terminal that will tell us here.
Listen for Hey Siri when your iPhone is facing down or covered.
So if you put it face down or covered, this determines whether or not it can, your phone continues to listen to HEY Siri or simply Siri. Okay?
Show apps behind Siri. Switch button off.
It shows if you want this, when you use HEY Siri, your screen goes gray and you don't see the apps or the home screen. This, I believe, toggles that off if you choose to have this enabled, so you don't have a visual indication on the screen. If you have no sight, it doesn't matter one way or the other. You can't tell. But for maybe a person with low vision or someone with sight, this could, you know, let them know the status. Is the Siri still enabled, follow-up still enabled or not? Here, there's a paragraph below. Let's hear that.
Allows the current app to remain visible while Siri is active.
Okay, that's kind of what I said.
Announce notifications on speaker. Switch button.
Here's another setting. Do you want Siri to announce your notifications? Mine is turned off.
Siri announces your notifications to you over your device's speaker.
Okay.
Call hang up. Off button.
Ah, this is one people have often asked. Can I ask Siri to hang up the phone for me? And here is this setting. It is a button. Let's open it.
Hey, call hang up. Switch button off.
I have that turned off on mine. I believe if you enable it, well, here's the paragraph. Let's see what it says.
Hey Siri, hang up is supported during phone and FaceTime calls. When a call is connected, voice input is processed on iPhone, and transcripts and audio are not sent to Apple.
So when this is enabled, you can ask Siri to hang up.
Hey Siri.
See, Hey Siri. If Hey Siri is enabled, you can ask it to hang up the phone. Off. Okay.
Hey Siri.
And that's it. That's how you can control your Siri follow-up. I hope that helps.
All right. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. Very good. Yes, good. Okay. All right. Great job. Okay. So now we're going to unmute and you're going to have questions for Brad.
One thing that wasn't in the recording. First of all, Siri follow-up, you cannot completely disable it. It's on and you cannot not have it. What I was trying to show you in this demo, one of the things was how to turn it off by saying thank you or just pushing the side button. Okay. But other than that, you're stuck with it on. The other thing there, Sandhya, I got a little carried away in editing. I opened to get to those Siri settings. I went to settings. I went to accessibility and opened accessibility. And then when you heard me do the four finger tap at the bottom of the screen, I went to, there's a Siri setting in accessibility, and it's all the way third from the bottom. There's a whole bunch of things in there, which is why I used four finger single tap just to jump me to the bottom and then go up to the third from the bottom. Okay, go ahead, Marty.
I think you kind of answered my question. So you can dismiss Siri by saying thank you or pressing the side button or the home button?
Yes, whichever one your iPhone has, yes. Or just simply say thank you. Siri right. will say, you're welcome, or sure thing, or something cute like that.
Okay, thanks, Brad.
Where is Brad? Oh, go ahead, Tree. Okay.
Who'd we have? Did I hear?
Liz,
go ahead, Liz.
Did you happen to say that you could turn off with the Siri follow-up and that? You could turn off the notifications?
There's a setting to have Siri speak your notifications that come in. But, you can also do that in VoiceOver. So there's two different ways to do that. So, but some people, this is not in VoiceOver. This is just in accessibility. So maybe you don't even use VoiceOver. You can go into this setting and turn it on and tell it that you want Siri to speak your notifications as they come in.
I want her to stop it because it messes with VoiceOver.
Well, I believe this is turned off by default in Siri, but you can go into VoiceOver, and there is a VoiceOver setting for that. I think it's in Verbosity.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
This is Sri.
Go ahead, Sri.
Yeah, thanks, Brad, because I just looked at mine. Mine was set to default, and I noticed that when I said thank you, it took me 3 Mississippis, but when I set it to longer, it was 1 Mississippi, and it cleared it out. So thank you.
Okay, very good.
This is Jerry from Vermont.
Go ahead. Okay, Jerry, and then I heard somebody else. Let's see, who was that other?
Marsha.
Marsha. Okay, hang on. Let's do Jerry, and then we'll go to Marsha. Go ahead, Jerry.
My question is, what else can you ask for follow-up besides the weather? Are there
probably anything. Okay. I was just sticking to the weather.
Yeah,
you can ask it the weather, then you can ask it, you know, when does my team's football game start or something like that. But Siri just stays listening to whatever you want to follow up with.
Okay.
It just keeps Siri listening.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead, Marsha.
I've just noticed that Siri, whenever I do anything with her, she stays on. And I think a long time ago I asked and somebody said, well, just press the side button and that would make her go away. So you're saying that if I say thank you, that she will quit?
Yes, either thank you or press the side button or home button if your iPhone has a home button. That's how you can dismiss the follow-up.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It may dismiss itself if you just let it sit there long enough. But
no, I want to move on, so I just wondered why I kept staying on all the time.
Yeah, it's just one of the ways it works. It debuted in iOS 17. It's one of those things that's got pluses and minuses. And
for sure.
Yeah, but just try saying thank you, and she'll come back with what you're welcome or sure thing. Or I've heard different responses to thank you.
Okay, thank you. Sure thing.
Sure thing. Exactly. You got it. David. Go ahead, David.
So if you change this pause time the longest, would that help people that like to use Siri, like to do text messages, so if they can get more into their message without being cut off?
I don't know if it'll wait that long, because you see, that's two different things. One of them is Siri listening to you speak before it cuts you off and starts its response. The other is asking Siri to read my text message, and your text message is really long. So,
right. Well, I'm talking about dictating. If you're like dictating text messages, I know people say something, they get cut off. I do too also.
It might do that, but again, to me, that's a different thing. That's your dictating, as opposed to asking Siri a question.
Well, no, like you say, hey, Siri, text, you know, John, and then you say, how are you doing? You know, are you going to be at the party? You keep saying stuff, you know, and then eventually you'll get cut off if you talk too long.
This is Pete. That's Siri telling you I don't know. That, again, to me, it's one thing to ask Siri a question. It's another to start dictating a lengthy text message. So I didn't check that one out. Go ahead, Pete.
Yes, that's how it was advertised when it first came out. I saw a 9-to-5 Mac or something on that, and that's exactly what it was intended for, David, is if you pause during your dictation, when you're using Siri for dictation, then it will give you more time.
Yeah, keep listening so it doesn't cut you off when you can't think of the next thing to say right away. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that could be it then. Try it out and let us know how it works. Anybody else?
Well, I'll wait. There's other people. This is Jerry again from Vermont.
Go ahead, Jerry.
I have a question about when I ask Siri to read my messages. Sometimes it will read them all and ask me for a reply, but sometimes it just kind of sits there and freezes, and I'm not sure why that's going on. And I imagine if I hit the side button, like you're saying, it'll be better.
Is Jim.
I think what it's going to do when you hit the side button is it's going to dismiss Siri altogether. Mm-hmm. It's going to dismiss the follow-up feature.
Yeah. Yeah, but I don't know how to stop it from stopping in the middle of my messages and giving me no verbal feedback at all whatsoever.
I don't know. Go, Jim. Let's see what Jim's got. Go ahead, Jim.
I was going to say that what I found is if you ask it to read messages, you're better off saying, Siri, read new messages, and it'll read the latest messages that come in. Or if you've been reading messages and you've missed any unread messages.
Yeah, good point. Just have to try it, see what happens.
It's Sharon.
Okay, Sharon, go ahead.
So were you saying that now in 17, you can tell Siri to hang up a phone call for you?
Yes, there was a setting in there in settings and accessibility. Go down all the way to the bottom to Siri. And then at the very bottom of those settings is a button that says whatever it said, ask Siri to hang up phone call or something, and you can open it up. And then you can enable it, but it requires that it said you must, hey, Siri. Now, will it work with, if you have it set to just Siri, probably.
Okay.
Wrote that without realizing, I don't know how long it's been there, to tell you the truth.
And we think this is after 17. You have to be in 17, we think,
it's
right?
I believe it's the iOS 17 feature. I mean, I discovered this feature while doing some research in order to do this BuzzBite segment. I'm assuming it's new to iOS 17.
Liz? No.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
This is Marty.
Thank you.
Okay. Marty, is it still on this topic or right on the robot?
It was just kind of one quick hint. It's on Siri. And
go ahead.
One suggestion I've always had the problem when I said Siri read messages because it would only read new ones. So what I do now, if I want to read the old ones, I change them to unread. Just swipe up or down a couple. And if it says read, you just toggle that to unread, and then Siri will read it.
Oh, it's clever. Okay. All right. Thank you, Brad. Very good. There's a lot of stuff in that bite. Okay, so now we're back to our regularly scheduled program, and we're going to answer questions of people that didn't have a chance the first half. Who would like to go? I'm going to give everybody a chance.
It's Chris.
Go, Chris.
Just real quick. So it sounds like if you use the hang-up version that it makes a transcript of your conversation. That's what it sounded like to me. So just, I guess, to be aware, it said it was not going to Apple and that little blurb underneath it when Brad did it. But it sounds like it's making a transcript of any FaceTime.
This is Brad. What Siri does when you use Siri and have asked Siri questions, get responses from Siri. Siri keeps a transcript is sent to Apple so that they can. My understanding is a transcript is sent to Apple so that they can, get feedback for how Siri is working. Okay. I don't believe they're storing it all, but what it's saying is a transcript is not being kept of your phone call.
It's Chris.
Is how I read that.
All right, Chris.
It was the hang up feature.
Yes, in the hang-up feature only. It's not keeping a transcript of your phone call. You say, hey, Siri, hang up, or, end call or something, whatever it is you're supposed to say, it will hang up the call, and it does not keep a transcript. My own pod now.
All right. Thank you. Okay, we'll have to try that out. All right. Thank you, Chris. All right. Who else?
This is Jody.
Go, Jody.
Can you use Siri to answer a call?
This is Sri.
Go.
I think you can.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Very good. Let's move on. Who else? New question.
This is Sri.
Yes.
So I did look at what Greg mentioned about editing, deleting a folder. It does not look like you can delete it if you don't click the edit button.
Cannot edit, do it with the edit button?
Yeah, so if you're in the, you know, the folder directory and you're trying to delete a folder in your mail, you have to be in the edit mode because there is no option to delete when you're, if you're not in the edit mode.
All right, thanks for that, Sri. Okay, next, who else? Who hasn't had a turn like to ask a question?
Sharon.
Go, Sharon.
So if you get like tickets, if you're emailed e-tickets, sometimes I see it'll say, put them in your iWallet. It'll be like, it'll appear automatically and I can swipe or whatever and it goes into my wallet. But that doesn't always appear. And I was wondering if, you know, you get museum tickets or tickets to a reading or something, if you want to put it like in your iWallet so it's easily accessible, can you do that?
All right. What a great question.
This is Brad.
Go, Brad.
Yes, you can. If it says it in the, if you get the ticket in an email and it's usually got a link, you tap on it, it can open it. You will usually find, if you swipe around in there, you'll hear it say add to wallet. And when you add it to the wallet, it will then add it in your wallet. Same place as boarding passes and things like that. Now you can have some settings in there so that when, let's say, you got tickets to the movie or to some other event, it tends to know when it's time. I know boarding passes show up based on time or location. And I've had tickets to a sporting event or something, concert, show up when it's either getting close to time for the event or when I get close to the event venue, there is an alert on the home screen about the event. And if you double tap it, it just opens the wallet and there's your ticket. Well, it opens the pass on the screen, or you can ask the Siri lady to open wallet and there they are.
Hey, very good. Brad, David, you were going to say something?
Oh, I was basically going to kind of say what Brad said, but I think it does also remove the passes after the, like after your flight is over or after your show is over, it seems to automatically remove them from your wallet so you don't have a bunch of expired events and stuff in there.
All right. Very good.
Brad?
Yeah, go ahead.
You know, my experience is you have to manually remove them. They go into a place called expired passes, and you have to open that up and remove them manually. I've never had them go away automatically.
Well, I guess they go away from your stack of your main stack.
Yes, they go into a place that you'll see a thing that says like expired passes or manage expired passes, and they're in there.
Okay.
Liz?
All right. Go, Liz. It's a new question. Hang on.
No, I think what I heard her say is, what if there isn't anything that says put to your wallet? Because I've had times when I've had something come up, a ticket, and there's nothing anywhere to move it to wallet. So then what do you do?
Okay. Was that your question, Sharon? Sorry, yes. We've gone all around this. Okay.
Oh, yeah, sorry. This is Brad. And you can't add it to the wallet.
Okay.
But usually I've really never seen where you can't add it to the wallet, but then that doesn't mean that's everything. Well,
obviously you... All right. Not the answer you want, Sharon. Okay, Sri, go.
Like I have the movie theater app. It doesn't go to my wallet, but I do get the information on the app itself. So did you take a look at the app that you used to get the e-ticket or?
Sharon, it comes in the mail. It comes in the mail. So I don't think
in
I know
email.
The app.
Comes in your email. Okay.
Email, sorry.
Oh, okay.
Okay. All right. Okay. So Sharon, yes.
Yeah, what I do when I get an email that has a ticket in, if it's not an airline ticket or something like that, then I will flick down and on that email, I'll flick without opening it. I'll flick down until I hear other or more and open that up. And then I'll flick right to notify me. And that puts it in a special mailbox in a threaded notification mailbox. And anything that's pending, I have in that threaded notification mailbox, and I can just quickly get through the five or six emails I have there and find the one I want. And so that ticket is just, you know, I can get to it real quickly.
Okay, so that's a good workaround. So put it somewhere where you can easily get to it since it can't go to the wallet. Okay, so you have a workaround. Okay, Sharon?
Thank you.
All right, thank you. And I think I heard David at the same time. Did you have a question also, David? Well, you did, but okay.
Oh, I was sent on those email folders.
Uh-huh.
I guess they have to be empty before you can delete the folder, I assume. You can't. Okay. Will you delete a folder with stuff in it, or do it have to be empty?
Hey, anybody, folder deleters? You have to empty the folder? What if it's your...
No.
No, it does not have to be empty?
No, but it warns you. If you delete the folder, you lose everything that's in it.
All right, good. That's good. That's what I would hope would happen. All right, next question. Who hasn't had a turn? Love to hear from you.
This is Jody.
Okay, hang on, Jody. Hold on. Okay, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, okay. I heard that in iOS 17 that you can turn on a feature so that it will automatically do CAPTCHAs for you. I had a CAPTCHA yesterday, and I'm like, oh, crap. I don't know how you automatically can have the phone do it for you.
All right. Who can help Jody? Automatic CAPTCHA to go through
those. Yeah, CAPTCHA.
Would like to go. Anybody?
This is Chris.
Go, Chris.
Wasn't that under settings in the first setting, your name and iCloud, and then there was one that said security and something, and at the bottom of that one, I think it said automatic capture.
Ah, okay. Thank you. I'll go check that out. Thanks, Chris.
All right. Very good. Moving on. Okay, who's next? Who'd like
Dawn
to go?
Houston.
Yes, Dawn. Go ahead.
I've asked this question before, but I think I'm doing something wrong. I was trying to add my printer to my iPad.
Okay. A printer to your iPad. Okay. And it's not working?
No, it's not. Like when I go to look on the, you know, scroll down, it doesn't have the name of my printer.
All right. And anybody have any suggestions for Dawn and her printer with her iPad? Are you able to use your iPhone to use a printer?
This is Jerry from Vermont.
Okay, go Jerry. Hang on. What, Dawn, what?
I said I never tried to do it to the iPhone.
Okay, all right. Go, Jerry, go.
I think it can be tricky sometimes because you have to have the printer. I mean, you probably know this, and talking out of school here, but you have to have the printer connected to Wi-Fi, and sometimes with an iPad, I believe you could use an HDMI cable to connect it to your either your printer or your modem, but you have to make sure it's on the same Wi-Fi that you're using, and then it should go across. Obviously, you have to turn it on. And when you go to the printer, when you want to print a document, you go to the printer settings and you should find it, Dawn, you know, but it has to be able to receive your iPhone or your iPad or your computer. And sometimes that's tricky. It has to be kind of reset up in order to do that.
Right, putting it on the right, exactly. Okay, Sri, anything to add to that?
Just what printer is it?
It's a Canon 8622 TRX, something like that.
Is there a Canon app that you need to install on your iPad?
I'm not sure.
Okay, that might be start.
That might be the problem, yeah.
Okay, so basically the phone has to see your printer, so the printer's got to be on the same network, and then like Jerry was saying, it hopefully will see it. Okay,
so thanks.
Try that out. Good job. Okay, next, who's
next? This is Jody.
Go.
I was just gonna say, when you want to print something out, don't you go to the share sheet and one of the options is print.
This is Sri.
Go. Yep.
Oh, yeah. I think the issue is that it's not seeing the printer.
Oh, she sees the printer. Okay. Right.
Usually, these printers usually have an ePrint app, so I would try that.
Okay. Very good. Okay, next.
This is Richard.
Go, Richard.
I was also thinking, too, because I've had problems with my iPad, too, with certain things connecting. You might want to check and see if they're even compatible, because for some reason, certain things are on my iPad says, no, it's not compatible. It won't do iPad, but it will connect to, well, which is not on this meeting, but
yeah.
Android.
Uh-huh. Okay. All right. Good to keep that, be aware of that. Thank you, Richard. Okay.
All right. Thank you, everybody.
Good job. Good luck, Don. Go next. Who else? Who else? Go.
This is Marcia.
Okay.
I have an individual that I text with, and I would like to make a different text tone for her, but I don't know how to do that.
Okay. Who? Somebody doesn't know how to turn on to help Marcia make a text tone for her friend? Anybody who has a friend? Tell her. Anybody? Go, let's go. Come on. Who'd like? She wants to have a special tone for a certain person.
Okay. This is Jody.
Okay, go ahead.
I know you can set up ringtones individually, but I don't know if you can set up text tones individually.
Oh.
But you would do it if you go to individually. You go to your contact and go to the person in your contact, and I know you can set up your individual ringtone there, but I don't know about text tones.
This is Sandhya. You're right. It's also there. You can set up the ringtones. Yeah. Okay, you're all set, Marcia. You will know who it is, and you don't have to listen to anybody else. Okay. So there you go.
Thank you.
All right. Next, who wants to go?
Liz?
Go ahead.
I know this was covered in a meeting like a couple months ago about how to correct misspelled words when you're typing, because I'm getting a lot of that with VoiceOver, that my typing skills are nil. But how do I find the recording I want to listen to?
Go ahead.
Okay, so you're saying you're getting a lot of what? Misspelled words?
Yeah, now that I'm typing with the curtain closed,
I can't
see what I'm doing.
Yes,
I have a lot of misspelled words.
Okay.
And sometimes I don't catch them right away, so they're like in the middle. So going to the front or going to the end of the text portion, I can't get to it, and I don't want to hit the delete all the way back to the word I need to fix.
All right. So it's a little more, that is what you're talking about, editing, like in a message, or what you talked about, files, you said, or something.
Any a message, to any
yeah,
paper.
Yeah, yeah. So that's, yeah. Go ahead, Terry.
This is Terry. What I do is if my, the things I need to correct, depending upon where they are, I'll put the cursor at the top or the bottom of the message. And then I use my rotor and go to words, or so it'll read words if I swipe up or down, or even lines if I need to skip ahead quite a bit. And then I get to the vicinity of where I want to make my corrections. And then I either go to words or even go then to characters till I hone in on the thing that I need to change. And then I can put my cursor below the character or characters that I want to change. And then I can press the delete button and delete those characters. And the trick is to make sure your cursor's in the right place. But then once you delete those characters, then you can then insert, you can type in the characters and or words that that you really wanted to be there in the first place.
All right. And that is a more advanced thing. So if you're still as a beginner voiceover user, that's kind of a little bit further down the line. Yes. But that's a great question. Okay. Yes, but it will come in time. Go, Shri.
I think what she was asking is, we did the demo on the cafe for voice control.
There was some kind of demo.
I'm sorry, what?
Yes, some kind of demo.
Yeah, we did a voice control demo. I think it was either October of last year, but you can definitely look it up on YouTube on the iBug Cafe. But it's called voice control.
Okay.
Okay.
But I think right now, okay, well, all right, then, yeah, if you're totally learning voiceover, you need to stick to voiceover because voice control is a different animal. But I mean, you can listen to the demo, but if you're learning voiceover, this will come later once you get a little more advanced. Okay.
This is Greg.
Wanting to open the curtain. Yeah.
Go, Greg.
Yeah. If you're in a text area, and sometimes this doesn't work perfectly, but if you're in a text area and you turn your rotor, you should find a misspelled words, and then you can just flick up or down and it will just go to any words that are misspelled. Although my experience with that, it's not always perfect. And if you're not getting that in your rotor, you might go to rotor settings in the voiceover settings. I don't think that's something you have to enable. I think it's automatically enabled. But yeah, it's real handy. It's just that it doesn't work perfectly all the time.
This is Ed.
It doesn't work for me at all.
Okay. All right. Go, Ed. We're going to move on. Go, Ed.
There's in settings, if you want to, as you're typing, listen to the words that are typed or not listen to the letters or whatever. I've got mine set so as I'm typing, when it finishes the word, it says what the word is. And if it's spelt wrong, it tells me. So I can just, I'm at it. I can back up right there and fix it.
All right.
So yeah, there is like a settings in there you can do that with. And you don't have to worry about trying to find it later.
Oh, autocorrect. Yeah, that has its own, you know, good and bad. Well,
not talking about autocorrect, just manually. Like you can have it so it reads each letter as you're typing it, but I find that annoying. But it just says the word, and if it's wrong, it tells me it's spelled wrong, and I'm right there.
Okay, feedback. Okay, yeah. All right, okay. Very good, Liz. Good luck. It's hard at the beginning, so hang in there. Okay, let's go. Who else? New question. Let's go. Who'd like to go? Final 7 minutes of our call. Anybody else?
This is David.
Go, David.
I looked up that automatic verification, you know, about the CAPTCHA, and it does say in there, if you go to the more info, that it may not work on all apps and websites. That's the disclaimer.
the caveat. Yeah,
because
right.
I still get them occasionally, but probably not as much as I used to, but luckily most of them now have the audio thing where you can click and they've improved that a lot too. They used to be kind of garbled. Now they're just usually like a snippet. It looks like sound like some kind of lecture, and they clip out 2 or 3 words.
Exactly.
You have to type those in.
Yeah. Remember the ones where it was like, had like a wind blowing.
Sounded like it was horrible.
Okay. Thanks, David. All right. Go, Terry.
Yesterday I had a CAPTCHA that popped up and I thought, oh great, what am I going to have to do here? And then automatically voiceover just said, we just need to verify that you're not a robot. And so then I just had to check that, saying that I'm not a robot, and it then moved right on. I don't know if that was because the website had put that in there, or it was something that, you know, the voiceover is, or that the phone is now able to do. I'm not sure where it came from, but I hadn't seen that before.
Okay. All right. Who else? Thank you. Next question. Getting close. Anybody else? No other weird stuff going on? I find that hard to believe.
Arlene?
Go, Miss Arlene.
I'm just curious. I really need a new phone because I have a 7S, but I want one with a home button. So did Apple say they'll never do a phone again with a home button? Should I keep waiting?
This
or...
is Terry.
All right, go Terry.
There are phones that still have home buttons, specifically the iPhone SE 2020 and the iPhone SE 2022, which is the more recent one, that still has a home button. And the, you know, those, the SE 2022 is going to be more reasonably priced than some other phones, so that can sometimes be an advantage for people as well. But those two phones definitely do have home buttons.
This is Jody.
Go ahead, Jody.
I just got an SE3, which is the the 2022, and I just got it last month, and it runs the same processor as an iPhone 13. So that's the one I'd recommend. It's the iPhone SE 2022, or they also call it the SE3.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
All right, who'd like to go? Anybody else? Okay, we are nearing the end here. All right, so just wrapping up for the first call of the new year. A quick review of what's coming up this week. So we have the mini buzz tomorrow from 5 to 6. Then Thursday, the book club, the 21-hour book. And then on Friday night, we have the 3.5-hour movie. We see a theme here. So, the movie is going to be good. Bring your snacks, take your nap, and maybe some Kleenex are involved. So it's going to be a good movie based on a true story, based on a book. So we hope that you'll come for that. Starting at 8 p.m. and go until 3.5 hours. And then we'll still have, there's a lot of good discussion and trivia and interesting information about the production of the movie. Then we have the iBUG Cafe talking about the music app on Sunday. So that is what is coming up here. And then we still have the after buzz. If you want to just hang on real quick and we'll stop the recording.